His slate blue eyes gaze at you steadily and with a certain enjoyment as you taste the Chateau Lafite that the waiter has uncorked, and you observe and listen to him as if you were part of a play in which you had the role of submitting to the designs of the leading man. Finally, he offers you a serving of bitter chocolate on a small, white, seashell-shaped plate, and he assures you that it tastes best accompanied by champagne. So he takes your hand in his big one, and he sweeps you along through the hallways while you discover that he's tall, and that you like his light chestnut hair and the way he carries himself, and you don't know whether it's his mixed French and Scottish ancestry or what you learned amidst the dishes, implements, tables, chefs, and waiters that is seducing you. He takes you to room 704. And you don't understand how the bottle of champagne got there first and is now reclining in a silver ice bucket. You sit on the sofa next to the bed and wait for him to offer you a glass while you silently observe through the windows and from seven floors up this strange city and your own acquiescence. You feel out of place in this position. You smile, and he of the slate blue eyes brings over the glass, and while you drink, he silently removes your shoes, unbuttons your blouse, and delicately searches for the center of each of your breasts to play with the nipple. Once again, you half close your eyes, and you surrender yourself to the big hands that have just stripped you naked and that hold you there on the sofa with the afternoon sun streaming through the window and the rug and his long nose sniffing at your neck, and his champagne-flavored tongue savoring your breasts, sucking from them the secret of their whiteness. He sucks on your navel, nibbles your legs, drenches your feet with his saliva, and strokes your belly as if he were checking the freshness of a Dover sole. He observes the response of the flesh and searches with an artisan's hands for your throbbing clitoris. He stimulates it delicately, as if he were seasoning a dish that afterwards his mouth had to savor, his tongue to wound. You've turned to jelly, a jumble of moist flesh, a cream of cockles, a dripping sieve of spit and membranes. You're completely edible. And he's gotten you to the point where you want nothing more than to taste him, to feel his sex growing in your mouth, drowning you, leaving you breathless, exalting your desire that he should pierce you, break you down, and skewer you, as at last he does, leaving you limp and abandoned, like leftovers on a plate.